Welcome to The Rich Report, a podcast with news and information on the world of big data. Today, my guest is from Tableau. We have Jock McKinley. He is the VP of Visual Analysis at the company. Thanks for coming on, Jock. What I thought we'd do is, I know you have a slide deck, but I'm really excited to see your demo because I've read a lot about Tableau. And we'll follow that with a Q&A.
Okay, sounds really good. I'm looking forward to talking to you and doing the demo. I love doing my demo. So, yeah, today I'm going to talk about the Zen of visual analysis. What I mean by visual analysis is a process to help people work with data. And the reason why you need to help people work with data is that people have cognitive biases. So if I were to tell you that a baseball and bat and the bat cost $1 more than the ball and asked you how much the ball cost, you're probably itching to answer 10 cents. But that's not correct. It's actually 5 cents. This is an example of a cognitive bias, the fact that people sometimes jump to conclusions really quickly. We're actually very, very smart, and we can jump to, we have this intuition that we can use to solve problems, but we actually need to do data calculations like this sometimes to get to the right answer. And we have all sorts of biases that data can help us with. And one of the problems about working with data is that people are slow at working with data. So for example, if I were to give you this problem and ask you to work it in your head, well, the problem is that we have limited short-term memory, and it's difficult to hold on to the intermediate results in computing it. But if I were to say, you can use a pencil and paper to work this problem, you would be able to work this problem much more quickly because you can use the external world to hold those partial results and come up with the answer. So that's the basic idea behind using visualization to help people work with data. And I have I hope this will work on your webinar. I have this really cute little psychological phenomenon called change blindness that shows you that we do use the world to work with, and if we mess that up, we can actually make it people very, very slow. Interruptions actually slow your ability to work with the world. And so this is a video I got from Ron Rensick, who's a professor at University of British Columbia, that's change blindness. What you're going to see in the video is this picture, then a period of gray in the picture again, and something will have changed between the two versions of the picture. And your job is to try and identify what's changing. So you can see there's this flash of gray, and then there's something coming back. And there is something changing between these two images. And the question is, can you see that? Scan around for a little while, and now I'm going to point it out to you if you haven't seen it already. It's this little ice chest here that's changing. And so just to give you a feel for it, I have another one where I took out the gray just so that you can see it. So in this particular one, you'll see that the blinking is very, very easy to see when there isn't that gray interrupt at all. So in fact, our visual system is very powerful for noticing change, but that gray, that interruption, decays the mental image we have of it and makes it difficult. So for me, what the problem is from an interrupt point of view, is user interfaces that are not really, really easy to use. Now I want to argue the other side of it, which is that the human visual system is actually very powerful. So here's a grid of numbers. And if I were to ask you to count the number of nines in this grid, you'd have to scan the whole grid, sort of like you were scanning the video I showed you a moment ago, and then color all the nines red, and then ask you to count them. And you can find that your visual system can separate out all the red objects from everything else. This is called perceptual pop-out, and it's a very powerful visual technique that we can tap to actually help you work with data. Perceptual pop-out is so powerful and so common that, in fact, even accountants use it to work with data. They color negative values red because, for them, negative values are really significant, and then that way those negative values pop out, and so they can work with the data very, very well. And this is the kind of techniques we can use to help people work with data, everyone. And so what I want to do is take the same data that you see here in this spreadsheet, and I'll code it this way as a bar chart. And you can see up here that I can see, for example, for coffee in the central region, that the sales is about half for amaretto, very, very easy visually. Whereas if I go back here, to do that same comparison here, I have to use mental math to see that amaretto and Colombian are in a ratio of 1-2. And so this is a much more effective way of presenting the data for people to work with it. And so what we want to do is tap this power of the human visual system and help people work with data. And we've gone off and studied lots and lots of people working with data, and the basic process is called the cycle of visual analysis. So you start up here at the top. There's some tasks that you're working on that where data can help. And remember, at the beginning of this talk, I talked about how people have cognitive biases. I believe that all tasks can benefit from data of one type or another. The first thing you need to do is get the data relevant to your task. You need to choose the visual mapping for that data because, what I just argued, the human visual system is very powerful. And then once you have the data in a visual form, you can look at it, develop some insight, and go off and act. And this is the basic process that we go through when we're working with data, particularly if we're using visual techniques. But in fact, the reality of this is it's a complex backtracking process. So you see I've drawn all of these gray arrows. You'll start with a task, you'll get some data, you'll get a view of the data, and you'll realize it's not the right view to answer your question. So you'll go choose a different view to work with the data. You might look at it and realize you don't have the right data. You'll go back and you'll get different data. Sometimes you'll realize you're not even working on the right task, and you'll change the task you're working on it. And what I find really, really interesting is that even if you get all the way to an insight, the first thing you need to do almost always in this world is to tell other people about what you found out. And you'll notice I put share here for act. And the moment you start sharing your insight with people, you're doing what I call storytelling with data. And that also requires backtracking as well. You need additional views to tell your story. Sometimes you need additional data to tell your story. And so this is a very complex iterative process, and this sets up what I want to demo, which is the process of visual analysis. And so for that demo, I'm going to start with this. Here's a Canada goose. And my question for you all is, what do you get when you have one of these and it hits one of these? That's an interesting question. You may recognize this picture. This is the U.S. Airways plane that did an emergency landing on the Hudson after hitting a flock of Canada goose. And I'm going to use this as my little demo for doing question answering, because when this happened, we went off and found out that the FAA had a wildlife strike mitigation working group, and they have an access database of reports from pilots. And it has typical information in it, which you can see here. There's the incident date, there's string columns like airport species, and then there's quantitative columns like height and speed. And so if I bring that data into Tableau, you'll see this here, you have more information than that. So you have information about the aircraft, the airport, the amount of damage. If I scroll down here, the flight date, origin state, and then there were quantitative columns like cost, feet above ground, and number of strikes. And so imagine I'm going to ask this question, is it safe to fly? I just learned about this U.S. Airways plane. And so the first thing I can do is drag out number of strikes and drop it on the row shelf, and I can see that there's about 136,000 rows here in this data set. That's too many rows to process as a single table, but now I'm looking at the data in a visual form. And so I can grab the amount of damage and drop it on the row shelf and break that bar apart. I can also drop it on the color shelf, and now we can see that there's about 32,000 where the amount of damage is null. What that meant is the pilot didn't even put in an amount of damage, so there probably wasn't any. 84,000 where he said none, 13,000 minor, and then down to a very small number. Probably pretty safe to fly because there's very few planes that have been damaged substantially or destroyed. But what also happens when you work with data using visual analysis is that other questions occur to you. So here's the cost field. What is the relationship between the amount of damage and cost? That's a good question. And I can answer that question visually just by dragging the cost field out and putting it on the column shelf. And so I get what's called a small multiple view. That's a term that Edward Tufte coined. And you can see on this dual panel display here that there's inverse correlation. The number of strikes drops, but the cost of it goes up. which isn't surprising because this is the amount of damage here. But what's a little surprising is the size of this orange bar. This is about $500 million of damage. And so that's a lot, and that explains to me anyway why the FAA has a wildlife strike mitigation working group. But I always recommend that when you're working with data, it's a slightly skeptical attitude. And I don't think I've completely nailed the question of whether it's safe to fly here. Because if you think about it, you know, there are different questions you can ask of data. There's this, we've been talking about sort of how much here, but there's also where and when questions. And, you know, maybe in my part of the country, it's more dangerous with respect to birds. I live in Seattle, and so there are lots of migratory birds that fly through here. And then there's also the issue about winds. Maybe it's getting more dangerous now. And so this always comes up in visual analysis. You get additional questions that happen, and let's go explore those. So, for example, I can go do the where question by dragging out origin state and dropping it on the detailed shelf, and I'll get this map here. And then I can pick up the number strikes and drop it on the color shelf. And you can see, you know, that there's a lot of bird strikes reported from California, from Texas, and Florida, which isn't surprising. These are very populous states. I get a vague impression that there's lots of bird strikes from Colorado, which isn't a populous state. Now, it turns out encoding quantitative data in color is not the most effective. I probably should have really dropped the number of strikes on the size shelf. And yes, you can see here that there are a lot of bird strikes reported from Colorado. And with a little more pondering, you might realize, well, that's a natural hub. People flying from east to west coasts often land in Denver. And so there could be a lot of bird strikes reported there. Now, I live in Washington State, and it doesn't look like it's a significant problem in Washington State, and you can look at your own states and decide you know, whether you should be worried or not worried about it. And then on and on, we could drill down and do all sorts of things, but I have only a short time to do this demo. Now, let's go off, ask the when question and start a new sheet as well. I can start over again the same way as before. I can drag out the number of strikes, and this time I'll go find the flight date field, and I'll drop it here. And now, here's a trend line, and your visual system is very powerful. There are two aspects of this trend line that leap out at you almost instantly. One is this growth over, this is what, two decades. There's been growth in the number of bird strikes reported to the FAA, and then there's this big drop at the end. And so, when you see things like this visually, you can form little theories or hypotheses about what might be causing that. And when I ask people about this big drop at the end, the answer that I often get, particularly from people who work with data all the time, is, oh, this is aggregated data up to year, and the data for the last year is incomplete. Now, we can verify that just by drilling down to the quarter level and then down to the month level in the summertime and the wintertime. In fact, that's true for every single year in this data set except for when I get to the last year. So that verifies that the final year is incomplete. And we believe at Tableau about making very direct experiences. So you'll see on this tooltip here, I have a way of excluding that point. Now we have the other thing, the obvious visual thing, which is this growth over time. And the question is, why is that? And when I ask people that question, I get a bunch of answers. One answer is that perhaps there's been more reporting going on over time. Another answer is that there's more flights. And sometimes some people say something I think is very amusing. They suggest that there are more birds. But unfortunately, I don't have a bird population database, or we could explore that one. I can explore the other two. So more reporting is actually the same thing I did before. Drag out the amount of damage, break apart the lines. You can see that the nulls are going up, the nones are going up. The minors stayed really flat until 2003, and then there was a bump up, and it's been pretty flat since then. But in particular, the medium, substantial, and destroyed have been pretty flat. I think this suggests that there's been more reporting going on, particularly because there's this huge leap that you can see right here between 2008 and 2009. And this, I happen to know, is the year that the U.S. Airways plane did the emergency landing in the Hudson. All the small plane pilots to actually report to the FAA about the bird that bounced off their windshield. And so you've got a bunch more none reporting during that period of time. Now, we can also explore more flights, because I actually have a flights database here. So let me show you that. This is a database from the FAA also about on-time arrival statistics. So I have airline description, departure information, destination, origin, quantitative is on airtime, arrival delay, and on like that. Now this is, turns out, if I drag and drop this, you'll see it's a significantly bigger data set than the other one. This is 147 million rows of data. And normally I would, back in the old days, I would have had to put this in a hot database, like a SQL Server box or something like that. But often we find that people who use Tableau technology are dealing with data sets of this volume and don't have a database nearby. And in fact, I'm just running on my computer here at my desk, and I'm going to be doing data computations locally. And in particular, what you're going to see is that when I drag out flight date and drop it here, there's going to be a pause. Now, this is a reasonably fast. Still, it takes a couple of seconds to scan through those 130 million rows and form the trend line here. And again, your visual system is like very quick and powerful. It notices this drop here, and it notices this drop at the end, and you want to form hypotheses about it. This is, by the way, 2001, so this is almost certainly 9/11, and then there's this drop here from 2007 to 2008. And most people guess that this is probably caused by the recession. And we can do the same thing as before. I can drill down to the quarter level. Again, I have to scan the 130 million rows. I can switch to the month level. The only thing I'll say is that it's less than a second or two. It's not interrupting me so much that I'm losing my train of thought. So here we can see for 1988 that there's a drop in February because there are fewer months in February. And you can see that that's true every month. And then you can clearly see here was 9/11 right here where the drop occurred, and in fact drops some more the couple of months right after 9/11. So that had a big impact on air traffic, and it took a couple of years to recover from it. And then over here, I think, is really interesting. Here in 2008, you see this big drop that occurred. And this is at the time when Lehman went bankrupt. And so that financial thing had an impact on flying. A lot of companies canceled their discretionary flying at the time. And then for the next few years, we've stayed very flat. And so this is clearly. And so the cool thing is, though, is I have this data set from two different data sources. I can actually combine them in Tableau up at the year level. If I switch, even though they're very different down at the row level, they're easy to combine the year level. I have flight date in play, so I have a little linking icon. And now I can drag out the number of strikes and drop it here. And you can clearly see that over two decades, these two data sets do not correlate. Anyway, that's my demo. Now I want to talk a little bit about how to go about doing this to make it very effective. And the first thing I want to tell you is visual analysis, that process of having technology that allows you to rapidly think with data, is not just about the aha. Aha is really important. Right? You can actually learn something that might actually make a big difference to you or your organization. No, the big value of this sort of technology, this sort of way of working with data, is that it saves you time. You can get work through your data much more quickly, and time, after all, is the ultimately valuable thing. And this is what people who use Tableau technology in particular find, really exciting, is that they can work with data and they can do it much more quickly than they could before. So my fundamental advice to you is to iterate, explore, and experiment regardless of task. All tasks involve data. And so how do we go about empowering individuals and groups to analyze and share their data? Well, to support the cycle of visual analysis I talked about before. And so I'm going to talk about four things in particular, which is that Tableau creates an experience that's incremental, expressive, unified, and direct. And so what do I mean by each of these? By incremental, I mean that you can go through this process starting with a view, drag and drop, get to another view, drag and drop, to get another view. This is the way people work really, really well. And if you can allow people to incrementally work through their data, then they can get to the answers quickly that they want to get to. And so the cool thing about that is that people get to start simple. And so you can start with the basics, and you can start almost immediately with the Tableau technology and start to answer questions. But over time, you'll get to richer and richer views. There's a lot of depth to the technology. The second thing is expressive. There is no single view for all data and all tasks. And if you think about my little demo about trying to ask whether it's safe to fly. You saw bar views, you saw map views, you saw trend line views. Well, there's a bunch of different views, and they're all useful for different aspects of data. And so Tableau is based on an algebra for describing data views. And so here are some of the examples of the different kinds of views that we support. And notice that I include a text table as one of the view types. A text table is a completely useful view for data if you want to know precise values. And so we work very hard to make our text tables very, very effectively. But of course, other view types are good. Maps are for geographic data. The trend views are good for data changing over time. Bar views are good for comparison. And scatter plot type views are really good for seeing correlations of one type or another. So my advice to you all is to reverse your thinking. You should start with the data. That's, after all, what you know the best is the data that you're working with. And then start with the data, drag your views out, and Tableau will default to the best view types that are useful for the data that you're looking at. The next thing I'm talking about is unification with the database, which is particularly relevant to the audience I'm talking to right now. So this is a little historical slide. Most of the world is still doing traditional reporting, where you have some database technologies where IT can, you know, write queries on the database, and they can also specify reports. Those reports can include graphics, and they can go out into the world. But the problem is that it might not have the right data in it for the individual who's getting the report to be able to answer the question. So in the research lab, when I used to be a researcher, we worked on highly interactive graphical interfaces for working with data, but you had to pour the data from the database into it. What Tableau represents is the marriage of these two approaches, highly interactive databases with a highly interactive visual interface for connecting to it. And in fact, so what we do is we write queries directly on the database, and we can connect to very large databases, including big data sources of one type or another. So Tableau, the major issue is, as long as you specify the result set data that's not too big, you can work at interactive performance, which is what humans need to do. And so this is the key, I think, to that Tableau being really valuable for a wide range of problems, is that it can be used on small data, it can also be used on very big data. And that means that we can unify with database technology as it's continuing to change. And so this image is just talking about, you know, having parallel computing technologies like MapReduce and being able to work with data of that form. And then the final bit is direct interaction. So what I showed this to you in particular with the commands on the tooltip. What we want you to be able to do is, you know, click on a mark and see all the related marks, directly work with your data value, because people work with data really, really well in a direct form. And so now I'm going to talk briefly about generating effective views of data. So these are fun. What I'm trying to illustrate is that we are making it so people do not have to be experts in graphic design or psychology. And so this particular image was from the Obama-McCain campaign, and this is Manhattan. And on the left here, you have Obama, and on the right, you have McCain. And you can clearly see that this is donation data. You can see that in a place where a Republican should have been getting lots of donations, McCain was obviously having trouble. But the reason why I show this to you is that we are using map tiles here that mute out the road network. At the time, in 2008, MapViews was all focusing on roads. But what we want is the data values to pop. And so we worked on the graphic design here and the psychology to make the data pop to the front and the road network just to be back as context for understanding questions. This is the kind of thing that we pay attention to make it to really tap the power of the visual system. So what you want to do is you want to have graphical views that communicate all the data, only the data, leverage the human visual system, be understandable and interpretable. And so I can go through that a little bit with some examples, sort of bad, good examples. So here we have a bar, dot, and line chart. And in particular, for a task of, say, looking at the East market, the problem with the bar chart is that it's difficult to estimate these values of the East values inside the chart against each other because they're affected by the other bars in the stacking. But On the dot chart, it's better. You can actually do the comparison of these values. A line chart is really good when there's time on the horizontal because that's our convention, and we can easily see the movement over time of the values for east. So this is the best view. This communicates all of the information, including the fact that there's time on the horizontal here. Another example of bad and good about leveraging the human visual system. So what I have here is market encoded by size of dot, or market encoded by color. And there are two problems about encoding market by size. The first problem is that this is not, although we will see these sizes as ordinate or in order, there's no inherent order here in the markets. So we're and communicating information that's not actually true. The second problem is it can be somewhat difficult to recognize what size belongs to what value over here. Not so difficult in the case of four values like market, but if you have 10 values, it gets very difficult to identify which size belongs to which one there. However, over here, market assigned to color works very, very well because of the perceptual pop-out effect I showed you before. Like, for example, I could say, look at all the blue marks. And you can instantly see that all the blue marks are in a linear relationship. Or you can look at all the red marks, and you can see, oh, they aren't in a linear relationship, and there's this big outlier here. Your visual system can separate out that particular color, and you can look at the correlations of those marks independently of everything else. So this is a very good encoding for categorical information. Now, the final thing before we leap into the Q&A session I want to talk about is understandable. So here are two interesting views that aren't understandable. This one up here is a node link view. And of course, the big problem with node link views is that they can be big spaghetti balls. This is very beautiful. The links are very beautiful here, but it's very difficult to understand it. And down here, this is an idiosyncratic coding of some data. I don't even remember exactly how it works anymore, but that makes it much more difficult to be understandable. And what I'm going to say about being understandable is that you want to annotate really well, and you also want to use dashboards. So here's an example of a simple dashboard, a multi-view display actually my CEO did of software IPOs. And so what you have here is a bunch of software companies and how long it took them to get to $50 million, and then you get the details down here. So if I click on here, I forgot to prime this before starting the talk. I should be able to get the view to pop up. Oh yeah, here it is. I can now interactively select these companies, or I can look over here at the slow burners, and I can do this interactive view. The cool thing about this from an understandable point of view is that each view here is simple and clear and provides the data I need to see, and then I can use interaction to work with the data together. And the key thing to notice here is this is running in my browser. It's actually very easy to author this view in Tableau and publish it up. So these are the sorts of views that you can use for storytelling. So the advice for that is keep your individual views very simple and combine them together. And so that's the basic talk, which is exploit the power of the human visual systems. You get to start simple, start with your data, and then keep your visuals very simple. And I actually have a slide with some readings that you can read if you're interested in diving deeper into this area. And Stephen Few's book is really accessible. And then there's Edward Tufte has a bunch of books, of which his first is probably the best. If you're into perception, there's Colin Ware's, and finally Jacques Bertin has got a great book called Semiology of Graphics, which is now in print again.
So Jacques, thanks for that. So question about that bird strike data. How big was that in terms of gigabytes? Was it a big set of big, large files, or what was it?
The strike data is actually very small. It's only about 100,000 rows with about 30 columns or so. So it's pretty small. The data about on-timeline arrival statistics is a couple of gigabytes compressed, and it gets bigger than that. It's bigger. Neither of them are actual examples of big data. Obviously, for a demo, there is going to be more lag when you're working with bigger data sets.
Right. Right. But would that kind of interactivity I saw, would that still be typical in a much larger data set? Is Tableau able to do that on a...
It can be. It can absolutely be.
Yeah.
I think the key thing to understand is that the questions you ask of the data set can't involve a big amount of data coming back to you. Mm-hmm. The key thing is that when you ask data, you're asking about data that's either filtered or aggregated. And so as long as you do filtering and aggregation such that the aggregated data coming back to you isn't too large, yeah, you can get similar performance on terabytes or even larger data sets. Now, obviously, the engine that's doing the filtering and aggregation needs to be fast. But you can get that interactive visual analysis experience on that data set as long as that's true.
Okay, Jack, well, I just wanted to ask you about your target users of this, because it seemed to me that this isn't necessarily just for data scientists, that somebody like an admin or even, you know, a product manager could go in and explore data without having a degree in statistics. Is that what you're going for?
Absolutely. We are definitely used by data scientists. They often ask questions, have many questions that don't require programming or this special use of a statistics package. So we definitely want to help data scientists. But yes, our target users are everyone. And our experience is that everyone can ask and answer questions with data without having to have the specialist skills of a data scientist. Absolutely.
Yeah. And as you guys add features and customers want more, do this and this, is that kind of a struggle to keep that simplicity there in terms of the interface so that it doesn't get too perplexing to use?
Yes. The interface that I showed you there, it has gone through 10 years of development. And yes, over that 10 years, we've added a lot of features. And it is a constant effort to make sure that we maintain the simple ease of use interface that we have. Now, we were very lucky in that we started from really good roots in terms of our understanding of how people work with data, and we have maintained that ease of use. In fact, mostly the interface is the same as it was 10 years ago, and what we've been doing is either adding features in or and sometimes tucking features in at one type or another. In fact, I'll show you a cute demo. We recently added tree maps to Tableau, and so I'll show you the demo about. So here we have wildlife species. So if I just drag out wildlife species, you'll see that this is about 600 species have been reported for bird strikes. And if I drop the amount of damage, you can see that there's only a few species that actually destroyed the plains and that sort of thing. But I can actually pick up, say, the number of strikes and drop it on the size shelf. And here's now a tree map of the same information. So we added this in a release or two ago, and we had to make some slight changes to our interface to make it really easy for tree maps. You can actually go like this, and you can see unknown bird medium is, and I can take the amount of damage off, but it's the largest for the none part of it. But you can see that gulls were reported a lot as not causing any damage. Whereas if I go over here and if I filter down to here, you'll see white-tailed deers have done a lot of the destruction on and on like that. So tree maps was a technique that we added in and we made it fit in with our user interface and keep everything as simple as possible. But this is, yes, this is a fundamental challenge. You add more features and you have to maintain the simplicity.
Great. Well, Jack, I want to thank you once again for showing this, and thanks for coming on the show today.
I really appreciate it, and love demoing the product, so thank you very much.
Okay. All right, folks, that's it for the Rich Report. Stay tuned for more news and information on the world of big data.